Haydi.
Tamam. Okay, good evening, everyone. It is our pleasure to host Gülşen Eryiğit and her student Berke Oral today. So let me first briefly introduce them to you. Gülşen Hoca is an associate professor at Istanbul Technical University, and she is the head of the ITU NLP research group and the coordinator of the ITU Language Technologies and Social Robotic Laboratory. She and her students have contributed a lot to Turkish natural language processing. And today we will hear about Berke. Berke has just recently completed his master's degree under the supervision of Gülşen Hoca. And he is also working for Yapı Kredi Teknoloji. So the project we will be hearing today is also, I think, have some applications there. And basically, today they will talk about their project on information extraction from text-intensive and visually rich banking documents. At this stage is yours, Gülşen Hocam.
Thank you very much, Aykut Hocam, for the first of all, for the invitation and then for the good introduction. Today we would like to talk about our study, information extraction approach from text-intensive and visual-rich banking documents, as Aykut Hoca said. The research results that we are going to introduce today is part of a TÜBİTAK 1505 project that I'm leading at ITU together with my student Berke, and which is supported by TÜBİTAK and Yapı Kredi Teknoloji simultaneously. So before entering to the experimental details and methodology, I would like to warm up a little bit you about the topic and the importance of the topic. In recent years, we have witnessed a resurgence of NLP studies on financial domain, and we see that many new workshops emerge. And they are co-located with well-known NLP or AI conferences. For example, workshop series on economics and natural language processing started to be organized since 2018. Workshop on knowledge discovery from unstructured data in financial services will be organized this year. Workshop series on financial technology and natural language processing has been started since 2019. These are some examples of the events, and there are quite some applications working on the field. The works mainly concern forecasting, auditing, and accounting. Regarding to the banking domain, information, there are not lots of studies in this domain. We have checked a lot during the publication stage, but we see that the information extraction has attracted the attention of the researchers since the early 1980s, and these were mainly with some rule-based systems. Today, the advances in NLP technologies, as we all know, such as textual representations and deep learning, makes possible to achieve this goal with much higher accuracy. Nowadays, customers interact with banks through many different channels, as we all know, such as mobile banking, internet banking, call centers, ATM machines, and conversational dialogue agents servicing on various platforms, as we all know and use nowadays, such as WhatsApp, Facebook, or banks' websites, and also on mobile applications. Although a significant part of individual customers, I mean retail banking customers, have started to prefer the channels that I just mentioned, corporate banking customers still prefer to reach the banks via written orders, surprisingly, because actually this was the first topic that had given to me when I was a master's student at ITU. I had received some grants from a large bank in Turkey. So I had started my studies related to the same topic. But I was thinking that the topic was over and we are all using online systems to send our money orders. So we are all retail banking customers, we are using our mobile phones and mobile applications for such kind of transfers. But we see that the banking customers in the corporate environment, the companies, they are still sending their orders via written orders, as you may see in the screen. And a medium large scale bank receives annually millions of such bank orders, written on letterheaded papers by financial officers of that company. And as you can see in the examples, they are blurred due to security reasons, but you may understand the general structure. They have logo pictures, signatures, stamps on them. So we may say that they look totally unstructured, but however, when a human reads this document, we still have a visual understanding of the document itself, and we know where is the main text is located in the screen. What happens? These documents are manually signed, stamped by one or more of the firm's executives. They are scanned and then sent to the bank either by fax or email. And as you may guess, this whole process yields most of the time to very noisy and low resolution document images. Additionally, since these orders are written freestyle in an unstructured manner and sent to the banking system in image format, the information provided in these documents needs to be semantically processed by human operators. So once the documents comes to the screen of a human operator, and these people have generally two screens, as I showed in the screen, on the left side, there is such a document appearing in the screen. And on the right side, the person tries to fill a form from its relevant information. And there are huge data centers where people try to enter this data into the banking system. And operator teams, there are different types of operator teams, and these consist of people responsible for document classification. Another group is responsible for data entry, and another group is responsible for validation and approval stages. I mean, if the signature is signed by a responsible person or not, or the related account numbers with the company, etc. Although it's not possible to eliminate the need for this validation stage in a banking scenario, it is possible to reduce the workload in other stages and speed up the entire process by the use of artificial intelligence technology and information extraction mainly. So this is another screenshot of a similar environment. For the banks in Turkey, service level agreements for EFTs, electronic fund transfers, denotes that fund transfers must be completed in 30 minutes after they reach the bank. And according to IMF, the International Monetary Fund, the highest rate of the orders are sent towards the end of office hours. So it is obvious that with the increasing workload, with millions of documents, automated systems need to help the human experts to achieve this goal and to do these transfers as quick as possible. So what is information extraction? Information extraction had been defined as the task of automatically extracting structured information from unstructured and or semi-structured text. It concerns the processing of human language. Therefore, researchers use extensive natural language processing techniques as a solution. And some NLP subtests studied under this topic, there are various actually, many researchers approach the topic from different perspectives. Some of the subtests are named entity recognition, as you may all guess, coreference resolution, relation extraction, template filling, and semi-structured information extraction, such as table extraction. Here you see a sample document. We may talk on it a little bit. With the rapid increase of internet usage, we know that the input format of this information extraction systems evolved from simple text to multimedia documents and post images and even speech. And this new situation forces researchers to explore new techniques to use information coming from this media. As in our case, we receive document images, and we believe that visual features could play an important role in addition to pure textual features. In this figure, we see a prototypical money transfer order, blurred again, where the sender wants to send some amount to two different receivers on the same written order. As you may see, visual layout of the document tells us where the main text appears. You see the logos on the top, left and right at the same time, and we see a signature on the bottom right. So how do we approach the problem? This figure on the slide shows our document processing pipeline. The document images are turned into textual data by the use of OCR technology, which produces quite noisy output due to low resolution or badly scanned documents. We do not, actually in this study, we do not focus on the OCR and document classification stages of this pipeline. I will give you some references on those, our different publications on those topics. But rather to, in here we will rather focus to the information extraction stage. Once the incoming document has been classified as a money transfer order document. So once the transaction information are automatically created after this information extraction stage, they are sent to the post-processing, as you see in the last row, the post-processing and human validation stages. Actually, for the cases that our system produce completely correct predictions, this whole process, the post-processing and human validation, will be just a click of approval. But otherwise, if the system did not produce correct results, the transaction is directed to the manual workflow and the human experts will work on it to fill the data. As you may see again in here, in the information extraction rectangle, the first stage in our information extraction system is the named entity recognition. And the second stage is the relation extraction stage. Different document types may require different structured information to be extracted. Some of these document types are also reflected to the screen. Also, although we do not specialize on all of them in this study, for giving some samples, I also showed you this picture. Here, only the first document is a monetary monetary transfer order, actually. So the other ones also have many visual clues, but we see that many of them are semi-structured. So there are tables on them, or there are tax payments, which have some specific templates. So we call these semi-structured documents. And actually in the literature, there are quite a lot of study to understand semi-structured documents. And especially they are treated from the computer vision perspective with visual algorithms, let's say. But fully unstructured documents, they are not that common in the literature, especially as document images. We mostly, the natural language processing community mostly work on such kind of documents from corpuses, from corpora, and they try to work on available data to the academy. So it's rare to observe such data sets where there are fully unstructured documents in visual format. And so the research relies between the two disciplines, document understanding and the from the computer vision perspective and the natural language processing. In addition to these, I would also want to add that also information stored in bank knowledge bases, such as relation graphs between companies extracted from transaction history, information related to people authorized to sign on behalf of a company, should also be fused to the process for automated correction normalization. Again, in this study, we do not focus in there, but it should, those stages should be also integrated to the post-processing stages in the last stage in this picture. So what do we do within money transfer documents? We seek to extract transactions as our structured information of interest. On the left side, you see such a document, again, blurred. On the right side, you see some information extracted by human experts. Each order may contain one or more, each document may contain one or more transactions in it. Actually, the first thing that an algorithm should guess is the number of transactions. Once these transaction numbers are determined, for each transaction, there should be a sender and a receiver. For this, the account numbers of them, the names, bank information, as well as the details of transaction process, such as the transfer amount and its currency type. So generally, in these orders, it is written that I want to send this amount of money to this person's IBAN address, blah, blah. You may, for the NLP people will think about this a little bit like dialogue systems or chatbots, where you are trying to fill slots, right? In those systems as well, we are trying to find some specific slots for intent classifications. So here we have one intent, actually, the money transfer, and we are trying to find the important slots of that problem. But the documents could be a little bit complicated. For example, in here, there is only one sender, and this sender could be the sender of multiple transactions, of course. There could be multiple senders as well. A sender may want to send money from his or her different money accounts. So the algorithm should detect all the abstract entities in the documents, create the transactions, put them in relevant sender or receiver blocks, and extract the detail, and then do the operations. So how do we model it? Formally, we determine some divisions. We call them sender, receiver, and process details. And we determine the abstract real-world entities under them. And we precise the slots for each division. We determine that some of them are mandatory fields, whereas some of them are optional. So the bold font ones in this picture are the mandatory fields, and the two mandatory fields in a single division may be used, either one or the other one may appear in the document. So what do we have in hand? Our data set consists of money transfer orders written in Turkish, which is an agglutinative and morphologically very rich language, as you may all know. And this feature of our language in focus yields to a very high number of possible word surface forms. Different inflected versions of the words, such as, you know, nezdinizde, nezdinizdeki, nezdinde, etc. To say that our account in your bank. So we have many words like this. So in addition to OCR errors, there are also spelling mistakes. I'm sure if I ask all of you to write to the chat screen the words that I just said, we will have many different writings, and it appears similarly in the documents. So these all poses interesting challenges in terms of the used language models and word representations. So I hope we made a detailed introduction to our task in hand. Now I would like to invite Berke to continue with the description of our proposed architecture and evaluation of it. And then at the end, I will turn back to discuss the future studies.
Our information extraction pipeline.
Berke, you can present yourself if you want. Will you continue from here?
Okay, everyone, I hope sees the slide right
Gülşen
now.
Gülşen Hocam, I think you need to stop sharing.
Okay, thank you.
everyone sees it?
Yes.
Our information extraction pipeline has essentially three modules in it. It takes the OCR input and first extracts the entities of interest, such as amounts, IBAN numbers, names, etc. And then we predict the relations in between them with a relation extraction algorithm. And in the result, we will have an entities and the relations in between them, which is represented in the graph. And we use a transaction extraction algorithm to parse the transaction within them. In this pipeline, we have two modules which we use a machine learning algorithm. They are named recognition and binary relation extraction. And we use a largely similar word representations in them. So I will go over them together. Firstly, we use language models to represent words. Those are BERT, ELMO, and FastText. To train them, we use the banking corpus, which has 4.9 million documents in them. We OCR them, take their texts and train them. In BERT, we further pre-train from case multilingual model. In addition to this, we have some positional embeddings, which I will discuss soon. And in our relation extraction model, we also embed named entities with embeddings. Since we actually don't update FastText and ELMO models during our task trainings, task level trainings, we also use the character where STM level to represent character level features in our to learn character level features in our models. The visual features we use two visual features. First one is positional coordinates method. This is a fairly simple one. In this method, we use words relative coordinates, top and left coordinates, and we use words bounding boxes width and height values. So it is a tensor with four values. In our grid embeddings approach, we divided the document into an equal sized rectangles and learned the embedding for each rectangle. And we picked the representation of corresponding rectangle while forming the representation. Our named entity recognition algorithm, there's not much to say about it. We use a standard BILSTM CRF approach. It takes the word representations I just discussed earlier and predicts the named entities. But extracting the transactions is a bit more challenging. First of all, like it's previously mentioned, there are multiple there could be a multiple transaction within a document. Slots of the transactions might be shared in between them. For instance, usually a same sender sends a multiple receiver, so the slots of them should be shared. The customer might write a value of a slot multiple times within a document. For instance, again, a sender name is often written multiple times in the header of the document, in the body section, in the footer, etc. And finding all of them isn't important because there's often an OCR error, and we need to use them in our post-processing stages. We have two previous approaches. First one was a rule-based approach. In this approach, we simply select the first account number as a sender and remaining ones as a receiver, and field accordingly values. This works most of the documents, but it is susceptible to small errors from name recognition or anything different a customer might make. Like sometimes they might write the details of a receiver first, etc. So it can also fail quite often. And second approach is to use a dependency parsing algorithm. So in this approach, a transaction in a document is represented as a dependency tree, and we use a dependency parsing algorithm to parse those transactions. Again, this is actually a bit hard for the dependency parsing algorithm because the syntax is a bit hard to parse. Like I previously said, a transaction slot might have multiple values, and if a slot is dependent on it, which it should be dependent on, and exaggerated is some problems. In literature, we actually couldn't find a similar approach and similar some algorithm that we could use directly in this problem. We searched a lot, but we find some areas where we can draw inspiration from. First of all, there is a complex relation extraction literature. In this literature, people first predict binary relations in between entities and represent them in a graph and use a maximum factorization operation to extract complex relations. There is also an event extraction algorithms, and in a sense, they are also extracting complex relations from documents. In these algorithms, they first find the trigger words, and using the other entities' relation to these triggers, they form the events. Our approach is a fusion of these two methods. We first predict binary relations in between them, then use a specialized relation extraction, transaction extraction stage to parse transactions. This is the binary relation extraction algorithm. We first create an entity representation for each entity using a BSTM layer. Then we concatenate them and feed them to a multilayer perceptron to predict relations. So what are the relations we predict? They are essentially picked in a way to make transactions separable in a transaction extraction stage. So it is more configured for a transaction extraction algorithm. We predict non-relation if two entities reside in a different transactions. We say they are same division if the entities are both in same transaction and is in same division. For instance, if two currency is in same transaction, we say they are in same division. if they are in different division, if two names different divisions, then we say they are other division, and so on. In our transaction extraction algorithm, our first step is to determine the number of transactions in a document. And to do that, we first create an graph which only has the amount values of a document. And we say that there is an edge between them if they have a same division relations between them. Then we apply a maximum conflict factorization to find what we call transaction routes. So we say that there is a two transaction routes here and here. And to avoid false predictions, we eliminate the clicks which has an intersection in between them. Then we iterate over these transaction routes to fill their slots. So to fill a new slot of a transaction, we first find the named entities who has a relation to the amount click, and we create again a graph from them. So in this case, it has a five named entities, and apply a maximum click factorization. And this time we select the maximal click for the sender name slot. And iterates for all the other slots to fill out these values. So our dataset has to be labeled 3,500 scanned and transferred documents, and selected 600 of them as a test, 400 of them as a validation. Often users, the customers sent to banks, the documents that they sent has a similar format. So customer usually, you know, just changes the receiver's account number and sends them. To avoid to make the dataset more diverse, we only selected one document per customer. For our evaluation metrics, we used the Connell score for our named entities, but to evaluate our relation extraction and transaction extraction stages was not that so trivial. We could use the relation graph, predict relation graph by the binary relation extraction stage, but and calculate F1 score from them. But it is not very useful. I mean, we cannot compare it to the other approaches. And it is not always perfectly represents how well the transactions are formed. So we also created two scores for this. First one was a slot filling score. In this metric, we checked the entities in a correct predicted slot, predicted slot and the goal slot, and see if they are matching. In the transaction extraction score, we look at the necessary slots of a transaction. Those are amount and currency values and sender and receiver's account number. So those have to be correct in order for the transaction to be deemed correct. And if those are not all matching, we say that transaction is wrong in the score. We trained each algorithm, each setup of our algorithm five times and report both their means and standard error values. We made some hyperparameter optimization for our base phase text model and try to use that hyperparameter as much as possible in our other models too, to not, you know, favor some setup because we selected better hyperparameters. So those are our name identification scores. Here in the top row, we have the CRF as our baseline, which uses handcrafted features. And here is the third row. We have our face text model. And below that, we have BERT and ELMO. And we see that expectedly we achieve quite improvements. But one noticeable thing in here is that BERT is actually underperforming ELMO. And there's a reason for that, because our documents are quite long. They often exceeded the maximum sequence length of a BERT algorithm. And in such cases, we needed to cut the BERT into the input of a BERT to sequence chunks and fed them into in such way, which resulted in context loss and hence the lower performance. And you can actually see that addition of PyLSTM quite improves the result because of this reason, but it is still underperforming the ELMO. Our relation extraction scores, as mentioned, we have two baselines, rule-based and transition-based, and our approach achieves quite improvements in both both slot filling and transition extraction fields. Here we see that BERT and ELMO achieves similar results. We also see that there was about 730 transactions in our test data set, and we can predict about 610 of them is correctly with our approach, which is quite a good number. And lastly, the impact of our visual features, positional coordinates and grid embedding approaches. Both of them improves the scores consistently, but we see that the grid embeddings achieves better scores against the positional coordinates method. And when we actually investigated why, this is mostly at the documents with multiple transactions within them. So it is looking at by knowing the first position, the algorithm can better separate the multiple transactions. And so these two algorithms are actually quite fairly simple methods, and we have working on other more complex scenarios and see actually improvements with GCN, CNNs, etc. And this was what I was saying.
Okay. And thank you. And we also try to understand the impact of the structure of the documents and their effects to these, or their relationship to these visual features. So we are looking to separately to multi-transaction ones, more complicated ones, the ones with higher, more complex relations. And we are currently in preparation of another publication for this. Hope to inform you in a soon feature about the progress. And I would like to conclude with a couple of more slides. As you may guess, there are a lot of engineering efforts on the background of such research. This study, of course, is a continuation of previous efforts of more than 5 years, actually. For the interested audience, we here list our previous publications and projects on the same subject. Two TEDEP projects where I was the academic advisor was also accomplished on the task, and several other methods have been tried before. Today, what we represented was a continuation of that, and it was part of my 1505 project, which is a continuation of these previous efforts. So I would like to thank you all, our previous colleagues from YapıKredi, for their valuable discussions and support. You may find the published version of this current work from the from this reference article, which is very recently published in the Elsevier's Journal of Information Processing and Management. And that's all that I would like to say. I hope you were in time. Yes, 40 minutes, perfect. I'm waiting for the questions.
Thank you, Gülşah. Thank you, Berke. Any questions from the audience?
I have a question. Can I ask it?
Of course.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So you said that like one customer sends probably like many transactions, right, over time, and they usually have a like similar structure for every transaction they send.
Mm-hmm.
And since like the bank knows which customer a transaction is coming from, could that information be like used in any way to like increase the accuracy?
Mm-hmm. It's a good question. Some of the fax devices that is known by the bank, so they are registered in the bank, and in such cases we can actually extract the sender's account number and name from programmatic, and just it is one of our post-process stages actually. Yeah.
Thank you. But so as a like follow-up question, so you can use the who sent the transaction, the fax, to get the account number, but also since the structure is similar from the previous sent like faxes, and I understand at the end of the like after this model will be used, there is a person checking and like correcting every mistake, right? So that's like even more ground truth data every time. Could that like in a, be used to improve the model as well?
It is, we tried it a lot, but it's often not very beneficial because the operator usually changes, for instance, name with some format and exaggerate. It's mostly decrease our performances.
Actually, one would expect that since there are millions of transactions every year, there should be like very big data in the banks, right? Which could be used in the machine learning algorithms. But unfortunately, that stage is not that easy to use because the actual annotation screens that they use, sometimes the logs are not suitable for using in the for our algorithms, and sometimes really the changes differ a lot. Maybe you don't see where the information is really relevant to which part of the document. So our annotations, we did a lot of annotation effort as well in these projects. Our annotations were much more machine learning oriented to prepare training data. But the actual, we tried a lot to align to the reverse engineering on the manual transaction information that the human operators are creating every year, every day. But it was not that easy to map this on the actual information. And you should also be aware that the OCR may just split the lines, may not correctly understand the column information, or sometimes there are lines appearing just between the just splitting the one page into two columns. So many strange things happens, and it's not possible to use every document in the training stage.
I see, thank you.
But both of the questions were very relevant, and thank you so much to have such precise ones.
I think Omar is raising his hand. Yeah, Omar.
Yeah. Thank you very much. Regarding the dataset aspect, so what I understand at the beginning of presentation is that we don't have many literature targeting this issue. So how, in your point of view, we can allow the community to contribute at the same time preserving the data privacy in such in such problem?
That's a very good question again, because I believe in academy, if we don't find such datasets to use, We may not produce good algorithms for such kind of real world problems. In academy, the relation extraction task is generally studied on conference papers, on publications on biomedical data to find relations between protein, because these were the available data to the researchers. Actually, I really don't have a good answer to this, because it's not the banking scenario is not the only scenario which has such kind of crucial data. Actually, even blurring the data is not enough, but they encounter similar situations in medical data as well, and they found solution to such kind of things. For example, the data is not shared with all the researchers, but some research institutes with some license agreements. So, but the NLP community as well should find a way to share data, but I'm not sure how this could be possible in the near future. It's a problem in the entire world. We will see.
So Gülşen Hocam, one activity we're involved in right now in this Turkish data project that TÜSİDE organized and we're both participating is basically we're talking to lawmakers in Ankara to possibly change the regulations to make it easier to share this type of data. Yes. Without conflicting with copyright law and KVKK. So there is some, yeah,
but even
some discussion going on. Yeah, mm-hmm. Go ahead.
Yeah, the discussion is huge, and I encounter situations where even the IT department cannot touch the data. For example, in this project, I'm not bringing the data to ITU. I didn't touch the data at all. Berke was my student first. Then he entered to that to Yapı Kredi, and he worked there in their server to do the research. And this, as I said, this is not just related to the banking domain. In law domain, legal domain as well, there are lots of things to do, but data is somehow private, and even the IT departments cannot work on the data. So yes, some regular issues should be decided first, but we will see. But up to that time, I always believed the necessity of this kind of industrial and university relationships. And I believe your lab also is an example of that, right? We work with SoftTech as well as ITU for long years in their chatbot systems. I'm the advisor of that, of İş Bankası as well. I mean the SoftTech. And I believe in this kind of collaborations for the researchers from academy to be able to produce results for these kind of problems.
I have a question about the relation extraction. So can you go back to that part of the slide? So you said that you do some kind of classification of the relation between the entity extracted and the other entity, the transaction, for example, right? This model. So here you do this for each pair that extracted by the named entity recognition part, right?
Exactly. And if there is an N entities, we make N square predictions.
I see. So So you do this independently for each pair?
Yes, we do it for each pair. Independently? No, I mean, not independently, I guess, no.
I mean,
independently. And this file STM just runs for one time. So the representations will be dependent, I guess, in that sense. So it is a at the end of it, there is an end representation for n entities. I take their cross product and just use an MLP to predict over that matrix. That explains.
I see. I've come across an approach using, the output, the entity representation part here that you, when you extract the entity representation, they apply self-attention to score each, score the relationship between each pair of entities.
I actually tried to use an attention, but it didn't improve the scores. I didn't follow it much, but it didn't improve. I guess the BioLSTM already encodes the relations in between them.
How many layers are there in the BioLSTM part?
One.
Only one?
Mm-hmm.
But the word representation already includes some relation, information about
it. Yeah, exactly. The ALMO already encodes a lot of the relations in between them.
So what is the hardest part of this problem? The hardest part to solve? I think the role extraction is a hard part, but you may have come across hard problems. For example, the named entity recognition isn't that hard, but
yeah, the relation extraction actually, because it is complex and it's not that studied in the literature. They are nested, intersentential at document level, and any relations. So that's why there was also a previous conference paper which preceded this one. And our contribution in both of these, we say that our main contribution is on the relation extraction algorithm.
I see. There is a paper that's called Jointly Multiple Event Extraction. You may have come across that. So they use the convolutional, that's graph convolutional networks, mm-hmm. to solve the relation part.
And they were using some dependency parsing algorithm. I think, are we talking about the same paper? No, I didn't see that. I didn't see.
I think Osman raised his hand before.
Yes, thank you. Yeah. Hi. So hello. You mentioned that you've been working on this project for a long time. So I was wondering, I guess you went through a bunch of iterations for your pipeline since it's such a complex system.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have suggestions for evaluating your pipeline as a whole? Mm-hmm. You can, of course, do individual evaluations of each part.
Maybe I can just open the article and show you some numbers. Let me find it. Actually, the end-to-end evaluation, you may find it from the abstract. So this is the article. Of course, since this is an end-to-end evaluation, it also has the post-processing layer and the classification mm-hmm. layer in front of it, the OCR, so on. When compared to the manual workflow, document processing pipeline shortens book-to-book money transfer to 10 minutes from 29, and electronic fund transfers to 17 minutes from 41 minutes respectively. and it is evaluated, like the details are given in the article, but it is evaluated like a 3 month or 6 month data evaluated on real scenario when the system is integrated onto the real work, real banking scenario.
I see. Thank you. Thank you. I will check this paper.
You're welcome.
So I have one last question. So I think this is also related to one of the questions asked before. So back when you mentioned that you can apply some kind of a post processing approaches to just maybe make some modifications in the prediction. So I was just thinking about the similarities between like open domain question answering, where you have a maybe large corpora and knowledge base that you can fetch some similar articles there to make some more consistent predictions. Considering that you have here lots of bank accounts, information, maybe names of the bank branches. So does that make sense to include those kind of like external memories into this system to make this like an end-to-end approach?
I mean, I didn't actually touch that part of the quote much, but there are some dictionaries for bank names, branch names, and etc. And there's like some small character mistakes are fixed.
Actually, I can answer that because Berke is in the project like in for 2 years now. Berke, maybe two years, I think. And actually, at the beginning, I have suggested to include such kind of basic tiers, the bank knowledge system, to the named entity recognition stage, for example. And actually, in the literature, there are cases where they say that even to the deep learning algorithms, it's good to integrate such kind of knowledge bases to the as features. But we had many researchers, of course, during the whole period, but they didn't receive higher results at the named entity recognition stage. It was surprising for me as well. But from the other hand, is that the OCR errors is so much that this DLSTM architecture also have character level encodings there. So there are, most of the time, there are not one-to-one strict matching with the knowledge bases as well. And as Berke said, at the post-processing stage, human annotators sometimes change the receiver name or the sender name so that it really doesn't appear in the document at all. Because you say yourself, I call my name Gülşen Hoca, but in the bank knowledge system, it is written Asok Prof. Gülşen Erit. So they didn't match at all, just the name sometimes. But I certainly agree that these data-driven systems should somehow fuse, come together to produce better systems together with knowledge bases. For now, it is done in the post-processing stage, especially to detect the errors, because you should validate an IBAN number, even though it is its relation is specified correctly, or even though it is recognized by the named entity recognizer, the value disambiguation type should be correct. Otherwise, you will send money to a wrong number.
Thank you, Dushanji. So, anyone? Any other question?
Okay, I think.
I think, we can end here. Again, thank you, Gülşen. Thank you, Berke, accepting our invitation.
For the invitation, and it was very nice to talk to you and for the very good questions that motivated us. Hope to see you soon and to collaborate in different projects.
Thanks.
Hopefully.
See you. Bye-bye.
Bye.